The creature first made national news in 1958, when construction worker Jerry Crew found and cast footprints measuring 17 and a half inches long near Bluff Creek, California, located 86 miles from Eureka. Locals nicknamed the creature Bigfoot, and the name stuck. Over the next decade, national interest in the story mostly faded until October 20th, 1967, when Roger Patterson, an amateur filmmaker, set out to Bluff Creek to do a documentary on a recent footprint discovery. But what Patterson found shocked the world. He shot 953 frames of film that many believe is the best evidence of Bigfoot. Patterson passed away in 1972, never wavering from his story. But he was not alone on that fateful day.
A massive bicep in the arm was, you know, wide like that. And as it moved, you could see the muscles ripping in the thighs. And the arms, even underneath that hair, you could see the difference in the movement.
Bob Gimlin was with Roger Patterson that day.
5, 5, 4, 4, 3, 3, 2, 1, 1, 1.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
Jesus Christ, you better... Sheriff, see ya!
Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Sasquatch Chronicles, a place where people share their encounters. Let's start the show.
I wanted to tell you, you calling me this morning meant the world to me. You calling me up this morning. I wanted to kind of tell you a funny story. And I might owe you some, I might owe you some medical bills. I might have to pay for some of your medical bills. We met at Beachfoot. I know you meet a lot of people there, and if you don't remember, it's okay. My brother and I had an encounter, and we heard that you were coming to Beachfoot, and I thought, oh man, I'd love to meet Bob Gimlin. I would love to meet this guy. When you had stepped out of your car, it was like the floodgates opened, and everyone ran to you. And I remember thinking, my brother at the time, he was saying, you know, I would love to ask Bob to come on the show. And I said to him, you know what, that's not a bad idea. And then the moment I saw you start to get out of your car and like everyone just rushed towards you, I remember I looked over at him and I said, yeah, I don't think I'm going to bother this man with that just because he can't even get out of his car at this place. So I was kind of bummed out. And we're sitting there at Beachfoot, and we were kind of in that inside structure. You remember what I'm talking about?
Yes. Yeah.
And I remember I was sitting there, and it was late one night, and me and Woody were talking, and I was kind of looking at the ground, and I don't remember if I, you know, we're drinking a soda or drinking a beer or whatever we're drinking, and I was telling Woody, hey, you know what? I'm probably going to head off to bed. I'm pretty tired. And I hear this click, click, click of cowboy boots walking up, and a hand comes out to me like someone wants me to shake their hand. So I put my hand out and I look up and it's you. And I said, you know, hey, Mr. Gimlin, he said, no, call me Bob. What's your name? And, you know, you went over to Woody and you were gracious. And I thought, man, this is the best time to ask him something about Sasquatch. This is the best time to, and then I couldn't think of anything to ask you. And it's funny because you were, and I'll get to my point of the story here. You started telling the story about how you had broken your back, I believe it was. Woody and I were just sitting there listening to you tell a story about, I think a horse had kicked you in the chest or had bucked you. I don't remember.
I can't remember. There's been a few horse wrecks with me for the last few years, you know.
Yeah.
I should have quit when I was younger, but I didn't. And so I'm paying a price for it a little bit, you know, but I heal pretty good, but I'm blessed. The Lord looks after me, you know.
You had told this story about how you got, I don't remember if it was kicked, somehow you had like broken your back or, and you were crawling back to the house. You couldn't get vertical and you were bleeding out of your mouth and you had ended up laying on your side. You're trying to get in the front door and couldn't get in. And you decided you didn't want to just drown in your own blood. So you laid on your side. Your wife finds you, brings you in the house, props you up in a chair and puts towels underneath your chin and basically feeds you soup for 3 days. And
that was a long, drawn out mess.
What was unique about the story, though, is you said, well, I thought I was going to die. And after about 3 days, I figured I wasn't going to die. And so I decided to go to the hospital. And I think right after that, someone wished you away. And Woody looks over at me and goes, wow, that's probably one of the toughest guys I think I've ever met in my life. What was funny is the next day after this whole thing, Woody's still kind of getting at me to interview you and interview you. I never got a chance to apologize to you for this, but I'll give you Woody's my brother. I'll give you his version of the story. Bob's sitting there with the busted, talking about how he broke his shoulder like a year ago, and he's holding this glass of water up, and he's talking about how he can't, a year ago he couldn't do this, and he had broken his shoulder, and he says, my knucklehead brother walks up to Bob and slaps him across the shoulder and says, hey, Bob, how you doing? And he says, you can see that glass of water drop a little bit. And then he goes, and then my idiot brother goes, yeah, Bob, you tough SOB. How you been? You look good. And slapped him across the shoulder again. And he says, poor Bob, you can see that glass of water dropping lower and lower and lower. And he says, my brother's such an idiot. He keeps going, you look good, yes, so be, you look real good, and slapping him across the shoulder. And he says, poor Bob had to put the glass of water down, and he was kind of slumped over. And he goes, Bob's so tough. The guy never says two words, but he goes, he knows he was hurting at that point. He walked off, and then my brother starts like verbally giving it to me, you know, just undressing me verbally. And he's like, what were you doing? And he tells me the little story, how you broke your shoulder. And then I was like, oh no, I owe him a, and I tried to find you to apologize. I felt so bad.
Well, yeah, you know, a person can't always tell when, you know, and so, but it's fine now, Wes. So we're all right, Ellen. Everything's okay.
Yeah, well, I appreciate it. If there's any medical bills I need to pay you for it, let me know, and I'll be glad to take care of them.
Oh, thank you very much. Now, I'm sure there isn't. I don't even remember much about some of that stuff, you know. I mean, my wife keeps track of it, but she did tell me this last time. She said, "Hey, you're getting too old to live the kind of life you've been living." She said, "I think you better not be doing that anymore, or you're going to have to find another address." I said, I kind of like it here, so I've changed a whole lot, Wes.
Yeah, I don't blame you.
Anyway, no, I'm just a blessed man. I mean, I've been blessed so much, and over the years, for, you know, the people that I've met through this thing, including you guys, you know, unfortunately, when I see you, I will remember, but, you know, I get Wes a powerful lot of names and stuff, and I was pretty good with names when I was younger, but now then I just can't seem to hang on to the names, you know.
I wanted to ask you, Baba, and I won't keep it too long, but I wanted to ask you, before we get to the whole film that you guys had done and your experiences with that, one thing I wanted to ask you, and it's something that's come up for me recently, you know, you had gone through this, even to the point where you guys filmed this thing, and it was something that happened to you guys. So many people have encounter stories, and then there's really no proof that the encounter took place. And you guys have it on film. How did you deal with the criticism, the blowback? Were you expecting that after all of this happened? Were you expecting the negativity?
No, I really wasn't. I didn't really give it that much thought because I thought, well, you know, I know what happened. I know what I've seen and all of that. See, I didn't, when I first saw the film, two or three days after, or a couple days afterwards, I didn't think the film was that good. I thought, well, you know, I saw more and better than that film is. But anyway, as everybody else kept saying, you know, this looks this good, this. So then I accepted it. And then when the ridicule started, then I thought, well, I don't like it, but I can handle it. And so I just kind of let it like water off a duck, you know, not really. It bothered me a lot about a lot of this stuff, you know, and it still does. But the thing is, there's been so many good people that I've met after all the ridicule, at the conventions that I've gone to, and people that have actually had sightings and had, you know, had encounters with them and evidence, then I'm just, I feel like every time I talk to somebody, it's just a little more of a weight lifted off me. Because, you know, when, right up in this part of the country, when I right away quick, everybody's, oh well, you know, those guys are faking things and they're doing this and that, and then people say, well, I don't know, Bob's not like that, and I don't know Roger, and so, you know, you get hit from every different angle, from everybody's different view. And so even at work, you know, I would get zapped a little bit. And then, of course, Judy would get zapped at her work. And so that's why I was, because one time I was asked, Bob, would you do it again if you had an opportunity to go back down there? And I said, no way. I wouldn't even think about going back down there again. But that was before 2003. And 2003, they had the Willow Creek there, the convention, and I and Dmitry Banoff from Russia and John Green and Chris Murphy and Tom Steinberg, we all went down. And so I met people at that convention that their interest was in it, and I never met one person that asked me about whether the film was real or whether it was a man in a suit, well, an ape suit or whatever. Never had one person address me with that. So I left there thinking, well, there is some decent people yet around. And they were from all over, you know, different parts of the country. And so then when I left there, because I was all through with giving interviews, I was all through with making any kind of appearance or anything. And that's in between the time when Renee Hendon was working, trying to get my one-third, supposedly my one-third of interest of the film. And so I was tired of dealing with that also, with Al Diatley and Roger Patterson and Patty Patterson, Roger's widow. I was just fed up with all of that because I didn't have time to be going to court and I didn't want to court. I'm not a kind of person that sues people for things or goes to, I don't believe in that. And so Renee wanted to do that. So I said, okay, well, you get the attorneys and you get it back. And that's the reason why when that was all through and they granted me back my one-third interest of that film, that I signed it over to Renee Duhannon for $1. And that's, people say, well, why did you do that? I was totally tired of it after 30 some years of ridicule and just happened to go through it. So I thought, I'm getting 3 square meals a day, and Judy and I are happy to be together still now. And she stayed with me after all of that. And so that's why Renee ended up with that. And I never did regret that I did that, and still don't. And, you know, Wes, there's time when, and I have my faith, you know, my true faith. And so I just, I let things kind of roll off me, because I've been protected and I've been blessed most of my life. And I was blessed all through this. At one time, I was a bitter, bitter person to Roger Patterson and Al the Attlee for what they did to me about, you know, doing the different things that they did, you know, traveling and having a guy go with them and say he was me and this things, and they made a bunch of money. And here I was working every day trying to make a living, or I was making a living. And when I got over, I got through that bitterness, I just thought, you know, why? I was the only one that paid for it. Patterson did. He's dead now. But I figured, you know, I'm a happy man. I don't have nothing to hide, or my conscience is clear. And I just wrote it off. And I've met incredible people since then. And, you know, I had invitations to go worldwide and do things with people that I just couldn't do, of course. But I've had the invitations to go and met some wonderful people. You know, Wes, and that's, I figure that I'm probably, of all the money that Roger and Al made, you can't buy the friends that I have acquired over this, over the years. So I figure that I'm much richer than they are, and it isn't with money.
You know, I admire you even more saying that, because I don't think a lot of people realize this film would have never happened if it wasn't for you. And a lot of people don't realize, I don't think a lot of people know the backstory on what happened after the film, you know, and I don't think people realize the ridicule that you took, and you were really put through the ringer. And so when you say, hey, would you go back and do it again? You know, your answer is no. I completely understand that. I completely get that. I wanted to kind of take you back to the 50s when you met Roger. You guys met through rodeo. You guys met through rodeo.
Yes. Yeah. Amateur rodeo.
Yeah. Well, amateur. I don't think there's anything amateur about rodeo, period. but when you met him, you really didn't, and correct me if I'm wrong on this, Bob, you didn't really know anything about Sasquatch. You really didn't know anything about, this was Roger kind of coming to you and saying, hey, look at, is that kind of how the whole subject started between you guys?
Yes, very, very much so, Wes, because I'd never even heard the word Sasquatch before, you know, and I hadn't heard anything about Bigfoot either. And you know, and I'd been in the mountains a lot, and hunted and did a lot of things. The first time that I really, the Sasquatch name, I think that I'd heard of Roger talk about the Bigfoot prior to the time of the Sasquatch. But I'd never, it was only because of the plaster, the casts that I think that Roger had showed me and said they're Bigfoot casts. Well, Judy and I got married in 64, and we went to Harrison Hot Springs for our honeymoon. And up there at Harrison Hot Springs, there was a big painting. There was a painting of on a big piece of plywood on a tree, or on a big stump, or whatever it was on. I can't remember now. It said Sasquatch. And Judy said, Sasquatch, what's that? And I said, I don't know, it must be a tribe of native Canadians. And then found out that Sasquatch Bigfoot was the same creature, see?
Did Roger come to you with more and more evidence. Is that, did you think this guy was crazy at first? Were you like, what are you talking about?
Well, yeah, definitely did. And of course, I was riding quite a few young horses in, and Roger lived back up in the mountains a ways, or on his way. He lived back there quite a little ways, and he was on his, he was in, lived in the way where I went up to ride these young horses in the mountains. So I'd stop by him. By then, the I wasn't around rodeo anymore. And I don't even know if Roger was or not, because I wasn't in touch with him. But anyway, I'd stop by when I'd go by there, if Roger was there, say hello to him, and he'd say, let me put my horse in the truck with you, and we'll go up and I'll ride with you. And I said, well, sure, come on. So, you know, around campfires at night, he'd play these little cassettes, you know, in his recorder, his battery-powered recorder, about different testimonials that people had talked to him about, and then he'd show me a plaster cast. I call it plaster. He'd show me a cast and say, you know, this is a Bigfoot, this Bigfoot. And then got to the point where he was calling it Bigfoot, Sasquatch. Well, by then, I had found out what Sasquatch was, so put the two of them together, so it was Bigfoot in the U.S. and Sasquatch in Canada. And so Roger talked to me about it, and I said, well, Roger, you know, I'm kind of like old Harry Truman. I have to see things to believe it. And so he'd laugh about that and talk some more about it, about the different people he talked to and the different places that he'd gone to that people had called him, that something strange had happened there, and he'd go investigate, and he talked to me about that. And this all kind of happened around campfires at night when we were on a weekend campout. And then he kept coming to me, you know, about this. And so then I can't remember whether it was in the spring of 65 or 66 or even maybe been the spring of 67. He come to me and said, Bob, he said, I've got a guy that is going to film us, and would you do some tracking for me and some riding for me in the mountains? I want to generate enough money with a little documentary, a short documentary film to mount an expedition in California, Northern California, where these down in Bluff Creek area and in that area. And I said, well, sure, Roger, I'll help you on weekends when I can. So I'd go up there with him, and that's when he had all these guys riding up there with me. And that's when I did the, and I was showing Appaloosa horses at that time. So I had a semi-costume like on the one in front of Argosy magazine. And so that was actually filmed for that documentary that Roger was going to generate it was going to put together to generate money to go for an expedition down in Northern California. And he'd already asked me if I was interested. I said, oh, no, I got a good job. I was riding horses and had a good paying job, and I had everything going for me. And so I just said, you know, Bigfoot's okay. There's got to be something out there, or these people wouldn't be talking about it, and there wouldn't be so much interest in it. But I said, you know, I really don't have time, and I'm kind of a skeptic. I'm still a Harry Truman type feller. I have to see it to believe it. I haven't seen it. I said, I haven't even seen a footprint in the soil that you could cast and make what you've been showing me. And so, you know, I mean, he didn't say too much about that. And I kept riding on weekends for him, you know, and tracking, doing tracking bear and cougar and whatever in the mountains. And then he said, well, could you take me over to Mount St. Helens on Labor Day weekend? Well, yeah, I'm riding some young horses anyway, so we'll just haul over there and I'll ride over in there, and we can look around over in Mount St. Helens area, because he was telling me what a active area that was, you know, for the Bigfoot prints and sightings and so forth. So we went over there and we rode around in the mountains, but it was a lot of downfall, they'd logged a lot over in there, and there was lots of garbage and stuff sailed around. So you couldn't get around very good. So it started raining really, really hard, like on Sunday night. And everything got wet. So Monday, Labor Day, Monday, I said, you know, I'm heading back to Yakima. And Roger said, well, yeah, it's raining so hard, there ain't nothing much we can do over here. So we come on back here to Yakima. And of course, I went back to work on Tuesday. And I don't remember exactly what day it was that Roger come in my driveway, big eyes wide open. Bob, he said, we got to go to Northern California. He said they found three different size of footprints around a piece of equipment that they put in there on a Friday evening before the Labor Day weekend. And then they come back on Tuesday to go to work, and these footprints are all around this piece of equipment, three different sizes. And I said, well, Roger, I can't just go. I was hot roofing at the time with a company here in Yakima. And I said, I can't just quit my job and take you down to Northern California. So I went and talked to the boss, and it was fall, you know, last part of September. And by then, it was the last part of September. And so he said, oh, yeah, he said, it's getting late. And I was not senior man on the cruise, so if somebody was going to be laid off for the fall, I would be the first one laid off anyway. And so that's why this all kind of happened the way it happened, you know, when I went ahead and took him down there. And I still don't remember whether it was the last day of September or the first day of October. It either had to be one of the two or the last 2 days of September, because I had a lot of things I had to get lined up here before I could leave here, you know, and my wife worked. I had horses and animals and cows to take care of, so I had to get somebody to look after them, because my wife wasn't going to be able to feed all them critters, you know. And so anyway, I got all that lot, got it lined up, and we went down there. Well, road, miles and miles and miles and miles, and it was one of them falls where was warm, you know, warm, sunshiny days almost every day. But my intent was to be able to see footprints in the soil when I went down there. That's what I really wanted to see, was footprints, evidence. Well, it had rained all the way down, up and down the West Coast. And I guess it must have just poured down there like it did over around Mount St. Helens. So when we got there, you could see where there was things in the dirt, but they weren't what you'd call identifiable footprints that you could put a product in there and come out with a plaster, good plaster cast. So I was pretty disappointed about the whole trip right from the get-go. And so then we just rode. We covered miles and miles and miles every day, and nothing. No footprints. And they up above us, where we were camped there, about a mile up above us, they were grading, bulldozing and grading new logging roads. So I'd go up there at night after they get the equipment off the mountains, and hoping that maybe something would cross the road and leave a footprint. Well, I found every kind of footprint up there but a Bigfoot footprint, you know. And so I just was not that all happy about the whole thing, because start with, it was my truck, my expense, and Roger's brother-in-law was supposed to reimburse me for all of the expense going down there. Because, you know, of whatever, because I guess he believed in Roger actually more than I did. I don't really know. But anyway, you know, he was had a company up here and was supposed to have money. And so I said, well, this rig I've got, I had a one-ton Chevrolet six-cylinder engine, and it was not easy on gas. It was a gas engine. And I knew it was going to be pretty spendy. Well, I absorbed the cost of going down and back and was supposed to get reimbursed about it, which I never did, but that's beside the point too, you know. But anyway, to make the go on with the story, well, going down there, you know, I didn't know where to go, but Roger had been down there in previous years to talk to some of the Forest Service people down there and Al Hodgson there at the variety store. He knew Al quite well, and he told me where to go. I'd never been down there, you know, and didn't know where to go. Well, this little truck was a four-speed manual transmission, so I could go in pretty steep hills with it in low gears with the horses in it, you know, if it was dry ground. I couldn't, you know, it was nothing like having a four-wheel drive rig or anything. And then where we camped, I'm jumping the gun here a little bit, Wes. Where we camped, I never knew that it had a name. And people kept calling it the Laos Camp. Well, I didn't know it was called the Laos Camp. It was just across the creek on the east side of the creek, because we drove across the creek. Creek was only about 15 inches deep, which was easy to cross, you know. And it had been crossed before with equipment loading logs, I guess, or something, because it wasn't just a straight off a bank and down and straight up another bank. It was agile, you know, kind of. It was kind of a grade like, and so I got on. We camped on the east side of the creek, which would have been Bluff Creek, and rode out of there every day. And then at nighttime, sometimes we'd take the rig back across and go up and drive. We could cover a lot more miles on them dirt roads if they were where they were blading. It was deep soil, but I'd just go in low gear with the lights on, and so we could see if anything crossed the road. But we, you know, we didn't have, it wasn't that far. And then just go on back, and the next day ride again. And this all happened and kept on going until October 20th. On a Saturday, we left out of there deciding that we would go about 25 miles further back than we'd gone before and stay all night and hope that maybe something happened back further. Well, we were only about 3.5-4 miles away from where we camped, and we'd come around up the creek bed. We'd come around this big downfall tree, and that's when the creature was standing by the creek.
Before you go into the famous footage that you had brought back, I wanted to ask you, so you go down there. If this is none of my business, say none of your business, Wes, but I can't imagine the conversation you had with your lovely wife. You know, you say you're going down to California from Yakima because Roger, you know, I'm sure you're explaining to her that Roger found these casts. And did she look at you and just go, are you crazy?
Well, she kind of did. But so even when we first got married, I rode a lot in the mountains by myself. No one wanted to ride in the rough country that I was riding in. So I rode hundreds of miles on weekends, long weekends by myself. Because my wife wasn't a horseback person, and well, nobody else wanted to go with me either. They just said, hey, I'm not going to ride with that guy. He rides where the crow flies. And so I rode alone a lot, and I was out a lot. So she was kind of accustomed to me being, and I loved being out in the woods, you know, and being by myself, because I didn't have to answer to anybody. And they didn't want to go where I wanted to go, and so I really didn't want people with me, because I could survive out there all by myself, perfectly comfortable, and live off the land and do what I wanted to do when I wanted to do it and go where I wanted to go, as long as I wasn't in danger of my horses. And I knew what they could do, so I in fact, some guys go with me later on and said, well, yeah, the story was told, you do go where the crow flies. Anyway, that's another story, you know, I mean.
Well, and I can't even imagine.
A little bit. Most people start going with me a little bit. I didn't go quite as rough countries as I did before when I went alone.
Yeah.
Anyway, yes, my wife didn't really understand. you know, quite a bit younger than me, and probably figured, hey, that old man's about half crazy anyway, because he's out there by himself in the woods all the time anyway.
You know, you're telling your wife, hey, I'm heading down to Bluff Creek. You get down there. You've spent all this money to get you guys down there. And then there's nothing. There's no tracks. I think I'd be devastated at that time. I think I'd be like, what am I doing here? You know, I realized.
And I did. And I said, you know, I'm going to head back here pretty soon because I got a job to go to, and or maybe have a job. You know, I mean, I left the job, and if they're still working, and because the weather, it was an open fall, better fall than that we'd expected. What was good down there, so I assumed it was good up here, which it was. You know, I mean, it was good because, I went back to work right after that when Roger and Al wanted to travel with the film, and I said, well, let's just stay here in Yakima. Well, I did go with them to California, and they messed around there. Then I went with them to New York. And I said, hey, I'm going to go back to work while I still got a job because, you know, this is not my cup of tea. I'm not used to traveling all over, and the Atlee was supposed to be paying for the expenses. Well, come to find out, some of the places he never did pay for the rooms and stuff we were at. I understand. I was told that he didn't. So, you know, he was notorious for skipping out on paying for things is what I understood. But, you know, I mean, that's a long time ago, so I don't know why. I never tried to prove any of it, and they never came after me for the bills, so I never bothered.
You guys are now coming around this bend, and Roger's actually ahead of you, and you're on your horse, and then you had a pack horse.
Yes. Yeah, I was leading the pack horse.
The moment Roger saw the creature, what did he say to you?
I don't think he said anything to me, a particular split second, because he was having trouble with his horse. And of course, I was having some trouble with, I just turned the pack horse loose because he was jerking and pulling on me. And I wanted to handle the horse I was setting on, because Roger was probably 20 feet in front of me, and he was having a hard time with his horse. And he was getting off and grabbing his camera out of the saddlebag, you know. And I used to say, well, his little horse blew up. Well, then I had to quit saying that because somebody said, well, what do you mean blew up? How many pieces was there, you know? So, you know, you have to really be careful how you say cowboy stuff and people don't understand it, you know. So I got to the point where I said, well, Roger was having problems with his horse to hold him and control him. And as quick as he got off, then he started to cross the creek. Well, I was just there, sitting on a horse, trying to control my horse, or was controlling my horse, watching him. And when he got up to relocate, he said to me, Bob, can you cover me? Because he was trying to get closer. He got up and ran at a kind of at an angle. Or the creature was going up through the opening there, and he was trying to get a little closer. So that's when I rode across the creek and got off. But that's the only conversation that we really had until after it was almost all over with.
When Roger said, hey, Bob, cover me, what was going through your mind? And then what was going through your mind when he saw the creature?
Well, I thought, God, they really do exist. They really do exist. When he said, cover me, well, I knew that he was a little apprehensive, you know, because we talked about it before. And, of course, I didn't know what I was supposed to see. And here's this great, huge muscle creature, you know. And so when I went across the creek and got off the horse, I knew if it came back that I could not get a shot at it sitting on a horse and it jumping around. So that's why I got off the horse and just stood there. Of course, I knew, you know, what he meant, be able to do something if it attacked him, if it came back, because he was trying to get pretty close to it at that time. So he was kind of running around up in another way when he got up. He stabilized himself down on the log with his arms and elbows. And then when he hollered at that to me and started to move around, and that's when I rode across the creek, kind of behind it, got down off the horse, you know, and it probably was at that time, 200 feet from me, maybe a little bit more than that. But it was close enough that I knew if it's turned around and come after me that I could get a good shot.
What kind of happened next? Did you guys just watch it? Like in the film, you see it just kind of walk off. Did you guys just watch it walk off? And then what was your guys' conversation like afterwards?
Well, no, I did. I don't know what Roger was doing because he was over. He was quite a little ways from me. When he said that about, I said, well, I'm going to follow it. I'm going to hold it. He said, no, don't leave me there, he said. Because later he told me, he said, I thought maybe there was two more somewhere there close because of the tracks of three different sizes. And so he said, let's catch my horse and get more film in the camera. Then we'll follow where it went. And that's what we did then.
Was this the next day you guys went back and tracked it or?
No, that same time, right? That same time, that afternoon.
And,
there was
and,
no next day of anything except pouring down rain and trying to get out of there with the horses in the trailer. That was a nightmare. I mean, that's a whole different story. Didn't think we was ever going to make it out of there.
When you guys went back to track it, how far did you track it?
Well, there was no tracks. It was just scuffs in the gravel. It was just gravel alongside the creek. It went right on up alongside the creek. And then we went up there probably a quarter of a mile or 400 yards or so. And there was a half of a wet footprint on a rock. And it headed right straight up through the cliffs and the rocks. Steep. And I wanted to follow on up. I wanted to go on up through there. But Roger said, no, we got to get back because it was getting in the afternoon, later in the afternoon. And down there, you know, the sun goes down about in October 20th, about 4 or so. So by the time we could get back down there and get the material to cast the tracks and take that film footage, you know, it was getting late. And by the time we got back down to the truck, it was dark. So he wanted to get in to Willow Creek and call. He had also talked to some people in Canada about track dogs, if he ever could get them to come, if he ever seen something, and track it. Well, he called up there, and then I don't know who all he called, but anyway, he called different ones. And then we had to take the film into Wairika or Eureka, which I always get those two towns mixed up. But anyway, to airmail it into his brother-in-law is what I understood he was going to do. So I just took him there, and I just sat out in the truck and took a nap or, you know, kind of fell asleep while he was inside. And then we drove back to our campground that night, full moon, bright as day, and We talked a lot about what we both seen, and of course the smell and different things. Of course, Roger didn't see the same things I did exactly, and then it started raining the next morning, early. I hear it hitting on top of the canvas on top, and I try to wake Roger up and say it's going to rain. I need to get up there and cover them tracks because I'd picked up cardboard boxes from Aldi Atlee's variety store to go cover the tracks until somebody could get there to look at them and the track dogs could get down there to start tracking them. But anyway, it was raining so hard the cardboard boxes were just soggy messes. So I knew they weren't going to do me any good to try and carry them up on the horse. So I just went up there and looked around, and there was dead trees with the bark still hanging on them. And I started pulling bark off them dead trees and covering the tracks. I'm glad I did at that time because I covered enough tracks that people witnessed them later on, you know, that went down. And I think John Green, Renee, and Bob Titmus, I don't remember who all went down because when we left the next morning, it was a nightmare for me getting out of there with that truck and didn't know if I was going to make it or not. And just a lot of things went into that deal getting out of there. It was really something. And then, of course, I just drove straight on. It took me a little day to get out of there, that 35 miles from where we camped into Willow Creek and get started on the highway to head north. And so I drove all that day and all that night to get back to Yakima. And they kind of browbeat me about not wanting to be in there to see the film at the first showing the next day or the day after, because I was still so tired and beat. I was still trying to get rested up from that. And then when I did go see it, I was not impressed at all with it. And so I kind of just said, oh yeah, you don't have much there. So they right away quick started talking about traveling with it and trying to prove it was authentic. And I said, why are you doing that? So we went to Canada. I went with them up to BC, Canada to a conference up there, and different ones got together there and talked. And but anyway, it just went on and on and kind of wild and crazy from there on until finally, I just decided, hey, I got to get back to work and make some money. And of course, that was in November or December by then. And so I went back to work, and then it was a short period of time then that winter did hit here, and there was no more hot roofing until spring. And then I can't remember whether I went back to hot roofing in the spring or went to another job. I probably went to another job, and because I was one of them kind of guys, if I didn't have a check coming in, I was looking for another job quick, and I never had a problem getting a job.
The whole story after the film is fascinating to me, but I wanted to ask you a quick question. I wanted to ask you, what did the creature smell like?
Well, I thought it had a musky, skunky smell. Kind of a musky-like, but it also had that rancid skunk smell. And Roger said, no, it didn't smell like that to him. But, Roger said different things, and he said, I don't know if you remember what he said, if you ever even heard what he said.
No, I've never heard.
He said it smelled like an old wet dog that had been rolling in cow shit. And so he might have said cow manure. No, he didn't. He said cow shit.
I appreciate you being on, Bob. The only last thing I wanted to ask you about, gosh, I wish I had more time with you. I know that you've had an encounter after that. You had an encounter in 2010. Can you real briefly talk about that encounter?
Okay. There was three of us sitting by a campfire up there at a place called what we call the Frog Pond, because they had all them places named that we used to camp out and do field research up there. And there was three of us sitting there at the campfire. It was about 9:30 at night. And I was getting ready to leave because I had to get back down. We were having a yard sale, backcountry horse yard sale. There was one guy that was sitting closest to the road, about 8 feet from the road, with his German Shepherd dog. We're all sitting there visiting. And the next guy over another short distance, 4 or 5 feet, was Colonel Kevin Jones. And then another few feet was me sitting in the chair. We was all kind of looking around the campfire there. We had a great big campfire thing, 5 foot across with the rocks and everything. And we heard something walking across on the other side of the road about, probably 60 feet over into the trees. Didn't think too much about it. And all at once it let out a yell, a holler that just would lift you plumb up out of the chair. And I thought, oh my God, what volume. And so then everything broke loose there again, too. The guy with the dog, it scared him really bad. He ran for his rig. He said, he didn't say nothing at that time. But then Colonel Jones ran to his tent to get his recorder. Well, the only thing I could think of was, is try to let out another hoop and see if we could get another one. Well, before I could even get out, I ran out into the road. And before I could even get ready to holler again, it let out another yell. And it was already quite a little ways away, probably 300 or 400 feet. And anyway, and of course, then I went ahead and let my little measly yell out. And then I decided that, hey, it's coming. It came through here. I'm going to stay all night, and maybe it'll come back. So I just put my tent up, and I stayed there all night. We had nothing else happen that night. In the same area, about 5 miles away, and I was asleep in my rig and didn't hear any of this until it was so much commotion that I finally woke up and found out what happened. I was about 200 feet from the campfire in my rig asleep. And I guess there was a young lady and her mother sitting by the campfire. One walked through the camp, and some of the guys heard it, but they just thought it was somebody getting up to go to the bathroom. Well, the young lady, walked right up behind them, about 20 feet behind them, and was just standing there. When she turned around and saw it, she just went into screaming hysterics. And that's when all the commotion woke me up. And I didn't know what was going on. They was getting her ready. They was taking her into the hospital. And then that's what they told me. Now, I never saw anything, or there was no footprints or nothing there, because the soil was packed down solid from people walking, you know. But anyway, that's the close ones that I was encountered to in the last few years, you know.
Well, Bob, I know that you don't do interviews. I know I had you for a limited amount of time. I know you got horses before the sun goes down. I know it's getting to that point, but I wanted to thank you for, like I said, calling me this morning meant the world to me. Coming on means the world to me more than you'll probably ever know. And it's been an honor.
Well, I hope I get to see you guys again. And you guys take care now. And I hope I helped you out a little bit there.
Oh, you helped me out more than you know. And I want to thank you.
still here.